Hello everyone, welcome to homeschool and we are with the third chapter of our science syllabus, that is metals and nonmetals. In our previous videos, we have already discussed two important chapters, right? So first one was chemical reactions and equations and the second one is acids, bases and salts, the most fundamental chapters of science. And this is again one more fundamental chapters that you are going to study in science, okay, which is very much important and interesting as well, okay. Fine. So metals and nonmetals, in your earlier classes you must have heard these words, isn't it? Metals and nonmetals, isn't it? So what are these metals and nonmetals normally? So in the periodic table you have so many elements, isn't it? We all have discussed basic idea about periodic table also. And if I ask you a question like which elements are metals and which elements are nonmetals in this, what is your answer? Say you have a periodic table backside of your textbook, you can open it and check yourself. You see the elements which were placed in light green color areas, light green colored boxes, they were called as metals. Okay, so which elements have been placed in light green color boxes? The elements that are coming from group 1 to group 12. Okay, so here I have a periodic table on a board, some rough periodic table. Group number 1 to group number 12, whichever elements are coming in this area, in these groups, all are called as metals. Okay, and group number 13 to group number 18, whichever elements come under these groups, they were called as nonmetals. Okay, few exceptions are there, I'll be telling it now. See, group number 1 to group number 12, you can see the elements, all these elements were there in light green color and they are having a properties of metals. Okay, and you know yellow color, you can see some elements were placed in yellow color boxes, that you will see from group number 14 to group number 18 here. You know all these are actually nonmetals. Okay, and some elements were placed in pink color boxes, you have only one zigzag line of pink color boxes, isn't it? And these pink color elements, you know, we will call it as metalloids. Okay, metalloids in the sense these elements have the properties of metals and nonmetals also. Okay, so they are intermediate between metals and nonmetals. So this is how we can come to know which is a metal and which is a nonmetal from periodic table. Okay, so fix a point in your mind, group number 1 to group number 12. Okay, whichever elements are there, all are metals. Some exceptions are there. What exceptions and all, I'll be dealing it in the next class. Okay, and group number 13 to group number 18, all are nonmetals. Okay, and some elements are metalloids here. See, the elements which are there in that pink color box are metalloids. Okay, and now the question is, on what properties did the scientist have classified the elements into metals and nonmetals? Yes, on what basis we have got this classification of elements into metals and nonmetals? It is based on physical and chemical properties of metals. Okay, metals behave differently, nonmetals behave differently. Metals look differently, non-metals look differently. Okay, you can observe the pictures of metals and non-metals here. See the metals picture. We have got the famous metals like gold, silver, lead, okay, and copper. See the color and see the shine which you can observe on a metal. And you have a picture of non-metals also. So here you have diamond, that is diamond is nothing but carbon, element carbon, which is a non-metal. okay? Diamond is there, sulfur is there, that yellow color powder, phosphorus is there, that red color powder, okay? So those guys are non-metals, okay? So they look differently, they behave differently, they react differently, okay? So we have two important properties called physical properties and chemical properties. Physical properties in the sense how they look, okay? What is their melting point? Are they soft and hard? Okay? Are they good conductors of electricity or bad conductors of electricity? So how do they behave normally, physically? Okay? So these are called physical properties. And chemical properties are nothing but chemical reactions. Okay, so if you put a metal in water, what will happen? If you put a non-metal in water, what will happen? Okay, how do metals react with oxygen? How do non-metals react with oxygen? You know, these chemical reactions are called chemical properties. Okay, so scientists have studied all elements' physical properties and chemical properties. Okay, based on that, they have classified all elements in our periodic table into metals and non-metals. Clear everybody? So based on what property you can classify the element? It is purely based on physical properties and chemical properties. Scientists have studied all the physical and chemical properties that they have discovered. Okay, so based on their studies, based on their discoveries, you know, they have classified the elements into metals and non-metals. Okay, now in this particular chapter, we are going to learn the physical properties of metals and non-metals as well as chemical properties of metals and non-metals. Okay, so they are very, very, very important, children. Concentrate and learn concept in a stepwise. Okay? And first and foremost, let us start with the physical properties. Okay? And I told you, what do you mean by physical properties? Physical properties are just the properties that you can see, the properties that you can feel. Okay? The properties that you can observe with your naked eye. Got to know? So these physical properties we are going to discuss with both metals and non-metals. Okay, so let us discuss them in the form of a comparative study. Okay, let us discuss point by point what property, how we seen in metals and how it can be seen in non-metals. Clear everybody? Fine. And let us go to the first point under physical properties of metals. Okay, so metals are generally hard. Okay, generally metals are hard. Metals are hard. Okay? They are hard elements. Metals are known to be hard elements. Okay? And non-metals are soft. Non-metals are soft. So here what is the property? Non-metals. Non-metals are soft. And most of them, most of them are either solids or gases. Okay, remember guys, most of the non-metals exist in the form of a solid or they will exist in the form of gas. Okay, and most of the metals are solids here. Okay, so most of the metals are solids. Okay guys, but some exceptions are there. We talk about exceptions little later. Okay, now we will just study the general properties of both metals and non-metals. Okay, so this is the first basic point that you have to understand about metals and non-metals. And coming to the second point, okay, metals are malleable, okay, and non-metals are not malleable. So what do you mean by the word malleable? Malleability means beating a metal into sheets. Okay, so usually metals are obtained as big rocks under earth crust. Okay, so you have to extract metal first, and if you can make that metal into thin sheets, then such a property we will call it as malleability. Okay, so what is malleability? Understand the definition very carefully. It is the property of a metal to convert it into thin sheets. Okay, so malleable means what? Making a metal into thin sheets. Okay, got to know. So such a property we will call it as malleable. So in the market we can see aluminium sheets are available, iron sheets are available. You can check the picture here. Aluminium sheets, white shiny aluminium sheets. Okay, similarly iron sheets can be available. Okay, copper sheets can be available. Got to know. So this iron, copper, aluminium, they are metals. So we can beat them. We can beat the metals into thin sheets. We can make them into thin sheets for the commercial uses. Okay, so such a property of metal we will call it as malleable. Whereas non-metals, you can't make them into thin sheets. Say carbon is there. Can you make it into thin sheets? No, never. Sulfur, can you make it into sheets? Have you ever heard of sulfur sheets, carbon sheets and all? Never, right? So non-metals don't have that property. Okay? You can't make them into thin sheets. Clear? Fine. And coming to the third property. Metals are ductile, whereas non-metals are not ductile. They are not ductile. So what do you mean by ductility? It is the ability of making a metal into thin wires. Metal into thin wires. Okay? See, like you can make a metal into thin sheets, you can also make a metal into thin wires. Okay, so you can observe in the picture, you have copper wire. Okay, so copper wires are available, iron wires can be available. Yes, in the electrical wires and all, you will find a copper wire. Yes, so copper is made into thin wires. So such a ability of metal, we will call it as ductility. Okay, so their meanings are very important to understand. Malleability means making a metal into thin sheets. Ductility means making a metal into thin wires. Okay, so this is very important. And one interesting fact is there. See, 1 gram of gold. From 1 gram of gold, you can make a thin wire of length 2 kilometers. Just try to imagine. You have 1 gram of gold coin. Out of 1 gram, you can make a thin wire of about 2 kilometers itself. Okay. So gold is very much a ductile element, and gold is the most malleable and ductile element. Remember this point. Okay. Gold, what is the symbol? Au. Okay. Au is the most malleable. Malleable and ductile. Here everybody, that's the reason gold is used to make jewelry. After gold comes silver. Okay, so gold and silver have highest property of malleability and ductility. So you can just imagine, out of 1 gram of gold coin, you can make a thin wire of length 2 kilometers. See how ductile the gold is, isn't it? So all metals have this property, but gold shows highest of ductility and malleability. Okay, fine. And non-metals, they don't show both the properties. They are not malleable and they are not ductile also. Okay, and the next property is metals are good conductors of electricity. Okay, metals are good conductors of electricity. Good conductors of electricity. Whereas non-metals are bad conductors of electricity. Bad conductors of electricity. Okay. So, why metals can act as good conductors? Because they have free electrons. Okay. Metals have free electrons. That is the reason always electrons are the guys which will carry electric current from one place to another place. Isn't it? They have free electrons in their atoms. That is the reason they are good conductors of electricity. Whereas non-metal atoms does not have free electrons. Okay. So that is the reason they are bad conductors of electricity. Okay. So these are some of the important points that you have to remember. And one more point is there here. The fifth point. Metals are lustrous. Metals are lustrous and sonorous. Metals are lustrous and sonorous. Whereas non-metals are not lustrous and not sonorous. Okay. So what do you mean by lustrous? Luster in the sense shiny. Okay. Luster in the sense shiny nature. Okay. Shining. So gold, copper, you have seen the picture, isn't it? So gold was looking in a very much shiny nature. You know, copper is also very much shiny, right? Silver is also very much shiny if you look at them. So that shiny nature is called lustrous. We call it as metallic luster. Okay. Metals will have luster. Luster in the sense shining. Okay. And metals are sonorous. Sonorous in the sense sound producing. Sound producers. Okay. So when you hit a metal onto a surface, you will hear a sound. Definitely. Yes or no? Say for example, now I'll bring an iron rod and I will hit. Definitely sound will come. So that property we will call it as sonorous. In the same way, see, carbon powder is there. I will hit on a surface. Do I observe any sound? Definitely no, isn't it? Sulfur powder is there. I will throw it on a board here only. Do I observe any sound? Definitely no. Yes or no? But copper rod is there, iron rod is there, aluminium vessel is there. I am hitting on the board. Definitely sound will come. Isn't it? So, such a sound producing property, we will call it as sonorous. Okay? So, remember this point. Metals are lustrous and sonorous, whereas non-metals are not lustrous and not sonorous. Okay? Clear everybody? And one more point here. So, I will be writing here. Lastly, I will mention. Okay. Metals have high melting point. Metals naturally have high melting points. Okay. They show high melting points. Whereas non-metals have low melting points and boiling points. Okay. Exceptions are there. General points we are discussing. In both the cases, some exceptions are there. We will discuss little later. Okay, metals have high melting and boiling points, whereas non-metals have low melting and boiling points. Okay, clear everybody? So these are some important physical properties of metals and non-metals. Okay, so try to remember all the points. It's very easy, and these points you kept on studying from previous classes onwards. Okay, so try to remember the meaning of the word malleability and ductility. They are very important here. Okay, and try to remember metals are good conductors of electricity and non-metals are bad conductors of electricity. You must know the reason why also. Okay. Let us discuss the exceptions in case of metals as well as exceptions in case of non-metals. We all have just now studied the properties of metals, isn't it? They are very much hard, Yes, and they have high melting and boiling points, and they are good conductors of electricity. And what else we have studied? Many aspects. They are lustrous, right? They are malleable, ductile, and everything, right? So it is not that every metal should show those properties. There are some exceptions. Few metals do not show those properties. And what are those metals? That is what we are going to discuss here. Okay, so see the first exception. We have discussed all metals are good conductors of electricity. Yes or no? But there is an exception. Lead and mercury. Okay. Lead and mercury are poor conductors of electricity. Okay. They do not conduct electricity from one place to another place. Okay. And the next point is mercury is a liquid. I told you a point. All metals are solids. Okay. But there is an exception. What is that exception? Mercury. Yes, mercury is a liquid and it is a flowy, shiny liquid, right? You can see it in a picture. It is a silvery, shiny, flowy. Okay, it can flow. Such a liquid we will call it as mercury. So, whereas mercury is used in thermometers also, you can observe mercury, isn't it? So, mercury is the only metal which exists in a liquid state. Remaining all metals exist in a solid form. Okay, so mercury is the exception here. And next point, gallium and cesium have very less melting point. So much less that they can even melt in a hand. Okay, got to know. So gallium, where is gallium coming? 13th group element. Okay, so gallium is also a metal normally. And where is cesium coming? First group element. In the first group, second element from last is cesium. Okay, so here both are normally metals. Metals normally should show high melting point, isn't it? But they have very less melting point. So much less that even when you take it in a palm, they will get melted off. You can see the picture. A guy is holding a gallium in his palm. Okay, and it is getting melted in the hand itself. Okay, he is not eating it. It is just getting melted in the hand itself. Got to know? So, remember this point. This is very important. They can even melt in hand itself because they have very, very less melting point. Okay, fine. And next point, alkali metals. What do you mean by alkali metals? The elements which are coming in group 1. Okay, which elements does come in group 1? Lithium, sodium, potassium, right, rubidium, all these elements are called alkali elements. Okay, they have a special name, alkali elements. And alkali elements are soft. They can even cut with a knife. What is the property of metal we discussed? Metals are hard, we discussed. Yes or no? Say when copper, iron is there, can you be able to cut with a knife? Never, they are hard. All metals are hard only, but exception is there. What is that exception? Alkali metals. Okay, you can see the picture. See the guy, he is cutting a metal with a knife. Okay, the metal is in white color. Okay, it's a piece of sodium and this guy is cutting a metal with a normal knife. Okay, that means the metal is so soft that it can even cut with a knife. Okay, so remember, alkali metals are so soft they can even cut with a knife. Okay, so these are the exceptions that you will find it in case of metals. Okay, so lead and mercury are poor conductors of electricity and mercury is the only liquid among all metals. Okay, gallium, cesium have very less melting point. They can even melt on a palm. Okay, alkali metals are so soft that you can even cut with a knife. So these exceptions you need to remember. 1 mark questions can be asked on these exceptions. Fine. And coming to the exceptions in case of non-metals. Okay. So the first exception is about iodine. So where is iodine placed? Iodine is placed in a 17th group, isn't it? So iodine is a non-metal. We know the properties of non-metals, no? One property, if you can remember, the last property which I gave you. The non-metals are not lustrous. Yes, not lustrous. Lustrous means what? They don't have shiny nature. Even if it is a solid, it will not have any shiny nature. Okay, that means not lustrous. But iodine is lustrous. You can watch the picture. See the iodine granules which are shiny in nature. Isn't it? See that brown color iodine crystals which are shiny in nature. Okay, so iodine is the only element, okay, which is showing that luster property, that is shiny nature. Okay, fine. And coming to the element carbon, we know the famous element carbon, okay, which is placed in 14th group, first element, non-metal. And this carbon has two allotropes. What do you mean by allotrope? Different forms of carbon. Allotrope means different forms. Okay, a particular element can present in many forms in our nature. Two important forms of carbon is there in our nature. They are diamond and graphite. Diamond is fully made up of carbon. Graphite is also fully made up of carbon. But diamond has different properties. Graphite has different properties. Like that, different forms of same element, we will call them as allotropes. Okay, so two important forms of allotropes are diamond and graphite. You can see the picture there. Diamond is there, graphite is there. And diamond is a solid which is very, very hard and shows high melting point. Okay, what was the property we studied for non-metals? Non-metals generally show less boiling point and melting point, I said. But see, this guy is showing very, very high melting point. Diamond is the hardest substance present in our nature. Okay, so no other substance is there as hard as diamond. Diamond is the most hardest one. Being a non-metal, diamond is completely made up of carbon. Okay, being a non-metal, it is hard. Yes or no? So this is one of the exception. You can see the diamond, how shiny it is and how hard it is, isn't it? So that's the reason it's having a very, very high melting point. Okay, and coming to the next allotropic form of graphite. Okay, so graphite is actually a soft allotropic form of carbon. You can see the picture there. And this particular graphite, completely made up of carbon. Carbon is a non-metal, but this graphite is acting as a good conductor of electricity. Okay, so carbon in the form of graphite is a good conductor of electricity. Graphite being a non-metal acting as a good conductor of electricity. So that is why this is one of the important exceptions that you have to remember. Okay, clear everybody? So the exceptions under metals and the exceptions under non-metals. Fine. So based on these physical properties, actually scientists have classified the elements in a periodic table into metals and non-metals. Not only these properties, we should consider their chemical properties also. Okay, so based on chemical properties also, we can tell whether some element is metal or non-metals. Okay, metals have different chemical properties, they react differently, and non-metals react differently. So now we are going to study, in the next video, we are going to discuss about the chemical properties of metals and non-metals. Okay, first we will discuss the chemical reactions of metals, and later we will go for the chemical reactions of non-metals. Okay, so revise this basic concept carefully. Try to remember all the exceptions, and you have to write everything in your notebook. Okay, take a screenshot of it. Thank you so much.